Naamah's Kiss by Jacqueline Carey. Narrated by Anne Flosnik. Copyright 2009 by Jacqueline Carey. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Jacqueline Carey, care of Dystel and Godrich Literary Management, and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Chapter 1. I was born to the Maghuin Dhonn. We are the folk of the Brown Bear, and the oldest magic in Alba runs in our veins. Once there were great magicians among us, men and women capable of seeing all the skeins of the future unwind in the great stone circles, capable of taking on the shape of the Maghuin Dhonn herself. No more. It changed long before I was born, when a prince of Terre wed a princess of the Culloch Gorham, the folk of the Black Boar. The greatest magicians among us saw the seeds of our destruction in that union. They acted to avert it, and in the end, they succeeded. But they did not act wisely, and there was a cost. The Maghuin Dhonn, already viewed with fear and suspicion, were despised in Alba for many long years thereafter. Our great magics deserted us. We turned instead to the small magic of concealment, learning to shroud ourselves and our places in twilight. It is a simple enough trick. My mother taught it to me when I was some 5 years of age. "Close your eyes and think of the time between night and day, Moirin," she said to me, "when the sun's last rays have sunk beyond the horizon, but darkness has not yet fallen. The stars are pale in the sky, and the trees are dim around you." I obeyed. "Breathe it deep into your chest and hold it," her voice continued. "Then blow it out softly, and let it settle around you like a cloak." I exhaled softly.
"Ha!"
My mother's voice was startled and pleased. I opened my eyes. A glimpse of gentle twilight fled, replaced by bright, hearty sunlight. It made me squint. I did it?
You did. I saw the air sparkle about you. You would have been concealed from any gaze not already upon you.
She dropped to her knees and hugged me.
I wasn't sure.
Why? My mother hesitated and stroked my hair. It was as straight and black as her own, but much finer.
You know that our bloodline is not entirely pure.
I nodded.
We are kin to the kings and queens of Alba and Terre, and the lord of the Dalriada too. Like it or not, aye,
she smiled wryly.
So, the gifts of the Maghuin Dhonn are not always given to each of us. I'm glad she has chosen you, little one.
I smiled back at her. So am I. It would be a terrible thing if she didn't, wouldn't it?
So it would.
It was some nights afterward that Angus came for the first time, or at least the first time I remembered. It was his scent that awoke me, a hard, clean scent like fresh-chipped granite and pine, with a musky undertone. Lying in my snug nest of blankets in our cozy cave, I opened my eyes to see my mother rise and go to greet the shadowy figure beyond the threshold.
Well? A deep voice asked. Moirin can summon the twilight.
My mother's voice was tranquil.
Does she show signs of other gifts?
No. There was a faint rustle as she shook her head.
Have you told her?
No. Her voice sharpened. She's a child, Angus, a child of the Maghuin Dhonn. Let her be one for as long as she may, forever mayhap. I would be content if nothing more came of it.
Peace, Fancher.
His tone was soothing.
It is just that there are those of us who wonder if she had not some greater purpose, calling you to a stranger. And then his tone changed, teasing.
Or so you claim. Mayhap it was his milky white skin and green eyes that drew you.
Hush, my mother said, but she was laughing.
Come into the night with me.
His voice dropped another octave.
I am here, and you have been too long without the company of men.
Hush, she said again, but it was different this time, amused but different. Something stirred beneath her voice, a current of something dark and rich and heady. It called to something inside of me, something I didn't know how to name. She glanced over her shoulder at me. I closed my eyes and feigned sleep. She went with him. I was alone. I wasn't scared. My mother had left me alone before, and I knew better than to mule for her return. But I felt strange. There was a fluttering deep in my belly, like a dove's wings beating. I called on my dear Anam, the spirit spark of the great bear herself that dwells in all her children. Something else answered. I had a sense of a lady's presence, bright and laughing, a sense of terrible beauty and piercing desire, though for what I could not have said, a sense of lips pressed to my brow in a kiss. Words filtered through my thoughts, fond, gentle, and amused.
Not yet. Not for many years.
The fluttering feeling went away. Comforted, I slept. In the morning, Angus was gone, and the night's strangeness had passed. My mother was in good spirits. We ventured upstream to forage for arrowhead root, filling my mother's wicker basket to brimming. Splashing happily in the stream's marshy verges, I forgot all about the man in the night and the bright lady's presence. When we returned to our cave, there was an offering. Eggs, my mother said with pleasure. She plucked one from the basket and passed it to me. Look, Moirin, see how perfect it is. I cradled it in my palms. It was warm from the sun, brown and faintly freckled. The shell was smooth. I touched the tip of my tongue to it. It tasted chalky and a little acrid. From Lord Tiernan?
I dare say, she smiled. He's a good man. He keeps to the old ways. We taught the Dalriada to survive in this land, and they have never forgotten it. He remembers we are kin, too.
She set the arrowhead root to soak overnight and made a savoury pie of eggs and greens that night. When I begged for the story of Lord Tiernan's coronation, she obliged me, tirelessly describing the splendid affair. It wasn't until I was falling asleep that I remembered last night's visitor and my strange vision. I resolved to ask my mother about it in the morning. But when the morning dawned bright and fair, and my mother promised to teach me to catch trout with my bare hands, I forgot again, and did not remember for a long time. As I grew older, she taught me many things. Most were simple skills. I grew adept at summoning the twilight, breathing it into me, blowing it softly around me. Thus concealed, I would lie motionless beneath the tendrils of the big willow along the stream, dangling one arm in the water and waiting for a speckled trout to swim into range. I could close my hand around it so gently it didn't even thrash, and lift it into the waiting creel. I learned to gather greens like purslane, watercress and dandelion, and roots like arrowhead, burdock and cattail. I learned which mushrooms were poisonous and which were good to eat. I learned to boil acorns until the bitterness was gone and grind them into meal. I learned to read weather signs and to track small game. My mother was skilled with a bow. When I was little, she hunted without me, but as I grew bigger and more adept in the ways of stealth and concealment, she took me with her. The first time I saw her kill, it was a hare. It was a big hare, fat and lazy, crouching in a sunny glade. It began to startle as we emerged from the woods. My mother called the twilight around her, and I did the same. The bright sunlight faded around us, the world turning soft and silvery dim.
"Hold," she breathed.
The hare froze. I imagined I could feel its heart beating, a fast, inhuman flicker. Its round, dark eyes gleamed. It saw us, and it saw its death in us. My mother loosed her bow. The twang of it startled me out of the twilight. The sunlit world came crashing back. The shot hare leaped, ran a few paces, and fell over onto its side. I swallowed hard. It seemed a much graver thing than catching fish, and somewhat unfair, too.
"Did it obey you?" I asked my mother.
She didn't answer right away, beckoning me to accompany her as she went to gather the hare. She laid my hand on its warm fur. I felt a faint movement as the last trace of life went out of it, then a loose stillness.
"In the twilight, we are closer to the world of spirit than flesh," she said soberly. "When we speak, their spirits hear. If their death is upon them, they obey."
"Oh," I whispered. My mother's eyes were dark and somber.
"It is a grave gift, and one never to be used lightly, only to sustain life. We give thanks to stone and sea and all that it encompasses for it, and to the great bear herself. Do you ever use it for sport or any idle cause, it will be stripped from you. Do you understand?"
"I do." The folk of the Maghuin Dhonn knew the cost of using gifts unwisely. My mother taught me things beyond woodcraft, cookery, and survival. She told me stories. Stories of days gone by, stories of heroes and villains, of great exploits and betrayals. There were stories from the oldest, oldest days when the world was covered with ice and our people left a distant land, following their dear Arnhem, the guiding spirit of the Great Bear, to Alba. I listened and shivered with awe.
"Have you ever seen her?" I asked.
She nodded.
"Once."
"Where? When?"
She shook her head. "It is a mystery, and I cannot speak of it until it is your time. But she is unlike any mortal bear."
"There were other stories, too.
The story of how the army of Tiberium conquered Alba, bringing stone roads and foreign sicknesses, driving us into the wilderness. How the mighty magician Donhe took on the shape of the Maghuin Dhonn herself and suffered himself to be taken into captivity and tormented for sport until he tore loose the ties that bound him and slew the Tiberian governor. Afterward, the disparate folk of Alba united and drove the Tiberians from their soil.
And yet we were despised for it."
"Why?" I asked.
My mother gave me her wry smile.
"The man who united the rest of Alba, Kinil Rú of the Culloch Gorum, lied. He said the Maghuin Dhonn had sacrificed their dear Arnhem and gone mad, that the same fate would befall them all unless they set aside their petty quarrels and stood together. And so they did."
"Without us," I said.
"Without us," she agreed.
"The world is not always fair, Moirin mine. And yet Alba has never been conquered since, and we are still here."
"A
And then there were the tales of our heritage. The summer that I was 10 years old, my mother took me on a pilgrimage to visit a place made sacred by our history. It was the most exciting thing that had ever happened in my life. We were weeks travelling. She taught me to read the Tashgig markers. The signs indicating the paths we travelled were held freely in trust for all of Alba. No one might bar another's passage, nor offer violence on Tashgig land. Of course we were prudent and concealed ourselves in twilight when others passed. Still, it gave me a thrill to see other people. My mother identified them for me in a low whisper, willing passers-by not to hear her voice. If they heard aught, they glanced around and shrugged, concluding it was merely the wind. The folk of the Culloch Gorham looked most like us, slight and dark, with black hair and eyes. But there were others I'd heard about only in stories, the Tariff Crow and Idlach Orr and Falair Ban, tall and fair-skinned, with hair that blazed like fire or gleamed like ripe wheat, startling blue, green or grey eyes. The first time I saw one, it stirred a memory.
Mayhap it was his milky white skin and green, green eyes that drew you.
After they had passed and we had released the twilight, I looked at my mother with her warm brown skin. I stretched out my hands and studied them. I was used to thinking of us as almost one person, but my skin was a different hue than hers, honey-coloured. I'd never thought on it. I closed my eyes and touched my lids. I wondered what colour my eyes were. I didn't know. It may seem strange, but what is obvious to an adult is not always obvious to a child. We led a solitary life. There was me and there was my mother. Other people were murmurs in the darkness, baskets appearing on the hearth. Tales out of history, tales out of lore. Until I saw my first fair-skinned stranger, it never occurred to me that the tales stopped short. I had no idea who my father was. Chapter 2. I kept the question to myself. I was a child, but I was old enough to reason. If my mother had not spoken of it, like as not she had cause. If she did not speak of it at Clunderry, I would wait until the moment was right. Clunderry. It was the place where things had gone awry and changed forever. It was the place where all had been redeemed. We arrived in the early evening of Midsummer's Day. Although I know now that it was a simple country estate, the castle and the surrounding village seemed awesome to me. I caught my breath as we emerged from Tashgig land into civilization. I expected my mother to summon the twilight, but she didn't. We passed the castle and walked onward. There were bale fires burning on the outskirts of the fields. Crops were ripe. I breathed deep, smelling rich, fertile soil. Once again, something new stirred in me. Roots. Growth. I closed my eyes. Behind my lids, I saw the figure of a man limbed in brightness, his head bowed, cupping a seedling in his palm. He raised his head and smiled with infinite gentleness. The scent of apples filled the air. Moirin, my mother said my name, calling me back to myself. I opened my eyes and shivered. We were approaching the burial mound. A man strode toward us, one hand on the hilt of his sword. He was a warrior of the Culloch Gorham in the old tradition, elaborate tattoos of blue ward whirling his cheeks and brow. More men waited behind him. And beyond them, others, my people.
Lady, the man said curtly, state your name.
My mother lifted her head to meet his gaze. Sunlight slanted over her high, white cheekbones. Thancher, she said calmly, daughter of Aenya, daughter of Brianna, daughter of Alais. He gave a brief bow.
Come in peace and be welcome.
I felt dizzy with the newness of it all. The burial mound loomed. It was a calm place, a tranquil place.
A place of death. And today, the Maghuin Dhonn watched over it.
Banshaw,
a man reached out his hand.
You came.
I came, she agreed, taking his hand.
Moirin, this is Angus.
He clapped my shoulder and smiled. The scent of musk and granite and pine surrounded me.
Well met, little one.
Others came then, gazing at me with dark, curious eyes. All of them bore the subtle stamp of the Maghuin Dhonn, a sense of wildness, untamed and dangerous. It should have been reassuring, but it wasn't. They regarded me as though I were other, and for the first time, I felt strange and alien to myself.
Has she shown signs of great promise? A woman whispered to my mother.
My mother shrugged.
Ah,
the other woman turned away, disappointed.
Moirin.
A man with laughing eyes came forward, proffering a short bow sized for a child's draw and a quiver of neatly fletched arrows.
Well met, little niece. I made this for you.
He kissed my mother on the cheek.
Greetings, sister. Do you prosper in your hermitage?
Aye,
she smiled.
Moirin, this is your uncle Maghuin. He has a gift for working with wood.
I had an uncle. Thank you, I whispered, clutching the bow and quiver. He tousled my hair.
Fine as silk.
He lowered his voice.
Does she...
My mother shook her head.
Ah.
The same disappointment.
Well then.
The sound of a harp arose, piercing and poignant and beautiful. I knew of harps only from my mother's tales, but even so, I could sense the mastery in the harpist's touch. He stood apart from everyone else, eyes closed. Mother, I touched her arm. What is it everyone expects me to be?
Hush. She rubbed my back with a soothing motion. We will speak of it, but not now.
She nodded at the burial mound.
Now is for honouring those who lie within, and remembering that such a thing should never come to pass again.
I gazed at the green mound. Our history lay buried there. A princess of the Culloch Gorham, great with child, the half-Dongeline child who would have grown to manhood and crushed the Maghuin Dhonn, hunting us down and destroying all our sacred places. And our last two great magicians, Morwen and Burlick, who had slain her and the child in her womb. They had broken binding oaths to do it. In the tales, they bore the mark of a magician, eyes as pale as moonlight, unheard of among our kind. My skin prickled, and I wondered again what colour my own eyes were. We stood for a long time, while the harp gave voice to a wordless song of knowledge, power and folly, and terrible sacrifice. Morwen's folly had been the most grave, and her sacrifice the most terrible. By the terms of the oath she broke, her spirit was condemned to wander for 10,000 years without solace.
Morwen. Moirin. I shivered some more.
What a dire night it must have been. No wonder we were still feared in Alba. I was filled with a reverent horror at the choices Morwen and Berlik had made, and pity for the poor princess and the babe that bore the cost of them. I and her husband, too, the Dongeline prince. Morwen had died here that night, but Berlik had fled north and ever north, mayhap seeking the land of our distant origin. The Dongeline prince had tracked him to the snowy ends of the earth and brought back his head. Dusk was falling. One last note lingering in the air, then the harp fell silent. An entourage from the castle was approaching across the field. A woman dressed in a fine gown rode at the head of it astride a chestnut horse. The armed men fell in to flank the party. Angus moved to meet them. He inclined his head in greeting. His gaze swept over the assembled Maghuin Dhonn. I felt my mother's hands on my shoulders, pulling me close to her. The twilight deepened around us as she summoned it, cloaking me as though I were still a babe. "Angus, son of Neil," the finely dressed woman said. "All is well between our people." He inclined his head a second time. "By stone and sea and all that encompasses, I swear it, lady." This time she inclined her head in response. "Go in peace." She glanced once more over us. "We give greeting to our wild kin." With that she took her leave, and her entourage went with her. My mother released the twilight, and I let out a breath I hadn't known I was holding. "She's kin?" I asked. "Aye," my mother said, "a descendant of Alais and Arwen's line. There's always one in residence at Clunderry." "Oh." It meant we shared as kin my great-great-grandmother, Alais the Wise, daughter of the Cruarch of Alba and the Queen of Terre. What tenuous place the Maghuin Dhonn held in Alba was due to her. She'd wed one of us, or at least a half-breed. Conor Mac Gronia, son of the Lady of the Dalriada and a wandering Maghuin Dhonn harpist. Their eldest, their daughter Arwen, had gone on to be named the Cruarch Talakan's heir and ruled Alba in the latter days of her life. Alais and Conor's other two daughters had answered the call of their Dia Arnhem and gone back to the wild places we liked best. They had married and mingled with others of our kind. "Why didn't you want her to see us?" I asked. "Surely we're at peace." "Aye." My mother looked around. The Maghuin Dhonn were beginning to drift away in twos and threes. "There's to be a revel, but there's somewhat I wish you to see first. There we will speak." We slipped back into the twilight. She led me back toward the castle, then into the woods along a path. In an ancient oak grove, she paused and breathed deeply. I did the same. It was a sacred place. I could feel the slow pulse of the earth beneath my feet. The oak trees dreamed their slow dreams, roots reaching deep into the earth, remembering year upon year of libations poured in tribute. A good place. But we didn't linger. She moved on along the path until we reached the circle of standing stones. This, too, was a sacred place, but it smelled of old blood, and the fine hairs at the nape of my neck stood on end. "She died here," I whispered. "Morwen." "Aye." "Am I named for her?" My mother hesitated. "Not quite, no. Come." I let her lead me into the centre of the ring.
There was a slab of a boulder there, half buried. Here was where the blood smell came from. My mother sat atop it with thoughtless grace. I stood before her, still clutching the bow and quiver my uncle had given me.
"You know the old ones were able to summon visions from the standing stones?" she asked.
I nodded. "Here is where she showed the Dongeline prince what his son would become. Only when it had come to that. Only when there were no other futures to see. And there were others at first."
She was quiet a moment.
"In one, Morwen bore the Dongeline prince a child."
"A daughter," I murmured. My mother nodded.
"She would have been a great magician who brought balance to the struggle and peace to the land. But the prince refused her, and her attempts to bind him failed in misery. That was her great folly."
Her mouth quirked.
"It seems the gods of Terre d'Ange are particular in matters of love."
"I am named for a child that never was?"
"Aye."
"Why?" Another silence. She let go my hand to brush fine strands of hair out of my eyes.
"Your father was Dongeline."
I remembered the words Angus had spoken in the night. "You were called to him?"
"I was."
"Was he a prince?"
She shook her head.
"A priest, I think."
"You think?"
"Peace, Moirin."
Something unfamiliar flickered behind her smile. "It was a revel, Lord Tiernan's coronation. I attended it out of respect. There were many foreign guests in attendance. I asked no questions, only answered the call. The priest felt it too. I dare say it surprised him."
"A priest of what?" My mother shrugged and spread her hands.
"I do not know. I am not versed in the ways of Dongeline faith."
I took a deep, shaking breath. "Yet you and everyone else expected a great magician to come of one night's dalliance?"
"I did not know," she said simply, "only that there was some purpose in it. So I named you for a child that might have been. It is not so unusual a name. Others have borne it. But it is a name with hope in it."
I swallowed. "And being no great magician, I disappoint."
"No."
Her eyes stretched wide. "Stone and sea, never." "Others," I said stubbornly. "I disappoint others." She sighed.
"They dream foolish dreams of glory, even as they remind themselves of ambition's folly."
She gestured around at the massive stones standing sentinel in the twilight.
"I wanted to bring you here, to tell you here, that whatever you become, that whatever destiny awaits you, no matter how great or how small, you understand in your bones the dangers of knowledge and power, and the toll they may take if used unwisely."
"Do you?"
I breathed in the scent of old blood and nodded. 10,000 years of wandering without solace. I understood.
"Good lass," my mother said softly. "Wise child."
My curiosity wasn't satisfied. "Why did you not wish the Lady of Clunderry to see us?"
"Ah," she touched my cheek. "You bear the stamp of Terre d'Ange on your features, Moirin mine. One of royal blood might question your presence among the Maghuin Dhonn. Our lives are our own, and I am not fond of answering questions."
"Not even mine?" I inquired. She smiled.
Yours I tolerate. What color are my eyes?
My mother cupped my face and kissed my brow.
Green, she whispered. Green as grass, green as the rushes grow.
Before that night, the revel that followed would have been the single greatest experience of my life. The glade in which it was held was spellbound, wrapped in a shroud of twilight that would render it visible as nothing more than a glimmering in the air to anyone without the gifts of the Maghuin Dhonn in their blood. There must have been almost 100 people there, a great gathering for our folk. There were even 12 or more children present, some near my age. I should have enjoyed the novelty. But I felt strange to myself. My father was a Donjeline priest. I was half Donjeline. And I had no idea what that meant, or why indeed it should mean anything. Surely there were others. I searched the memory of my mother's tales. No, never such a pairing. Not between an almost pure-blooded Maghuin Dhonn and a pure-blooded Donjeline. So, why should it matter? It shouldn't, and it didn't. Except that my mother had been called to him, and he to her, and she had named me for a child that never was. Now the words whispered in a long-ago night, and today's disappointed looks made sense. For 10 years the Maghuin Dhonn had hoped I would prove to be a great magician. It made me angry, at them, at my mother. They had no right to place such expectations on me. She had no right to withhold such a great truth from me.
Pouting little one?
Angus stopped to crouch before me. No, I lied.
Ah, she told you.
He turned his head to gaze at my mother. A trick of the moonlight through the branches laid shadows like antlers over his tangled hair.
She's a deep one, Fancha.
There was a fire in the centre of the glade, burning silvery beneath twilight's cloak. Bare-chested young men were leaping through the flames to the accompaniment of clapping hands and skirling pipes. One swaggered up to my mother and bowed to her, holding out one hand. She shook her head, laughing. Angus's eyes narrowed. "Do you love her?" I asked him.
"Aye," he said simply. "I'd have her to wife if she'd let me. But she's solitary and set in her ways."
He looked back at me.
"Do not judge her harshly. She bears a great love for you, and in her own way seeks only to protect you."
It made me feel ungracious. "I will try."
"Good lass."
He rose and moved away. The revel wore on into the small hours of the night. There was music and dancing, and an abundance of food, even roasted venison, which we seldom had. There were stone jugs of ishka, a strong spirit begged or bartered from elsewhere, or stolen from tribute gifts left by other folk. I found a jug with a scant inch left in the bottom and sampled it when no one was looking. It tasted unpleasant, but it blazed a trail into my belly where it simmered nicely, smoothing away the prickly edges of my temper. I decided I liked it. The children I'd been too sullen to attempt to befriend began to yawn and crumple, curling up in the grass to sleep beneath the stars. Men and women smiled at one another and went into the darkness together. When Angus held his hand out to my mother, she gave me an inquiring glance from across the glade. I shrugged. She took his hand and went with him. I should have been weary, but my heart and mind were too full for sleep. I found another jug that sloshed a bit when I shook it and wandered into the night. The charm of concealment had darkened to the deepest purple twilight. here and there couples were sighing. I found a place on the outskirts of the glade with long grass and sank into it. In the tree above me, an owl hooted softly. I summoned my own twilight and spotted it. Hello? The owl hooted again. It sounded disapproving. The glade was its nightly hunting ground, and we were disturbing it. I'm sorry. I let my twilight go and sensed a rush of powerful wings as the owl launched itself. Good hunting. There was only a little ishka in the jug, but it was late and I was growing tired after all. After I drank it, my head spun. I curled on my side in the tall grass and thought about all the coupling in the glade, or the midsummer coupling in the tame fields beyond the woods. I knew what men and women did together. I'd seen frogs mating. There was that queer fluttering feeling in my belly again. Combined with the ishka, it made me feel excited and sick. Not yet, the bright lady whispered in my memory. I closed my eyes and listened to the grass crackling beneath my ear. I thought about the other one, the one I'd seen in my mind's eye earlier. The man, bright, though not so bright as the lady. His gentle smile, the seedling cupped in his palm. I opened my eyes and gazed at the grass. There was a tiny half-opened buttercup nestled amid the long stems, colourless in the fading twilight. I breathed in the remembered scent of sunlight warming the ripe fields, taking it deep into me where it mingled with the warmth of the ishka. There was no sick feeling left, only calm and goodness. I cupped my hand around the blossom and blew out softly. The buttercup opened. Well, well, I thought, mayhap I wasn't a great shape-shifting magician like those from the days of old, but mayhap I had some small magic that was all my own. Or was it? Was it a gift of the Maghuin Dhonn, or the mysterious unknown gods of Terre d'Ange? I wasn't sure I wanted to know. I murmured a prayer to my dear Annam and sought refuge in sleep, comforted by the rustling grasses. Chapter 3. It was a blessed relief to return to the solitude of our cave. I spoke less than was my wont on our long journey home, and my mother did not press me. She spoke only of inconsequential things. She taught me to use the short bow that my uncle Mabon had given me, praising my fledgling skills. As we travelled, I got to be quite good with it. She did not speak of my father, and I did not ask. I did not speak of the buttercup. Nor did I seek to repeat the attempt, not during our journey. But I paid greater attention to the world around me than I had paid before. Raised from childhood in the wilderness, I had always been attuned to it. Now it seemed that awareness had deepened, as though a sense I'd always possessed had awakened more fully. When I concentrated hard, I heard the songs trees sang to themselves, reaching their leafy crowns toward the sky, sinking their roots deep into the earth with a slow, satisfying slither. Not heard, not exactly, but it was a sense like hearing. A stand of birch trees grumbled in the shadow of a great spruce. The grasses and scrub of wide-open spaces flourished with a brief, exuberant shout. Wildflowers whispered delicately and perished. And animals. It was harder because they moved, but I could sense them too, if I stayed still enough. Once a fox vixen trotted across our path, a grouse hanging from her narrow chops. She saw us and froze, one forepaw raised.
She's got kids, my mother murmured. Half grown, I reckon. Needs to feed them with autumn coming.
I felt relieved, but I wasn't alone in my ability to sense such things. You can tell too.
Aye, of course. And you're growing into your skills if you can. She looked at me sidelong, then addressed the fox conversationally, summoning a flicker of twilight and making a shooing gesture. Go on, you.
It trotted away fearlessly. Do you hear the trees grow? I asked her. The grass speak? My mother shook her head.
No. Do you?
I took a deep breath. I do. She eyed me.
Well, that's a fine thing, isn't it?
Is it? My mother smiled.
To be sure, Moirin mine.
But it's not a gift of the Maghuin Dhonn, I pressed her. She walked without answering for a while.
I cannot say for certain. Surely there have been those among us tied to the sacred places, the springs and groves and the standing stones. But you sense this everywhere.
I murmured. Not easily, but I.
She shrugged. Mayhap it is a gift we have lost.
Mayhap. I thought of the man with the seedling and said no more. At the end of our journey, we found our neat, cosy cave had grown foul and smelly and messy with neglect. Mice and other scavengers had gotten into our stores and nibbled holes in our blankets. It took days to set matters in order, sweeping out droppings and spoiled foodstuff, pounding our blankets on rocks in the clean, cold water of the stream and hanging them to dry. It was hard work, but I didn't mind. It was good to be home. By the end of the first day, we had cleared away the worst of the debris, but a rank odour lingered. I wrinkled my nose. Shall I see if there's pennyroyal yet blooming in the meadow?
'Tis too late in the day.
My mother made a face too.
And I fear a stench too great for pennyroyal. Do you have a sense we've further unwelcome visitors lurking?
I shook my head.
Nor I.
She dusted her hands and cast a glance at the sky. We'll sleep in the open air tonight and have a closer look on the morrow. As it happened, we didn't have to wait that long. My mother built a merry fire in the fire pit, while I plucked a grouse I'd shot the day before, much to my considerable pride. We roasted it on a spit and ate it along with handfuls of late-ripening blackberries. As the soft blue light of dusk began to settle over us, I felt warm and content. Insects buzzed in the last summer air. Along the stream, trout were feeding. Tomorrow, I'd catch fish for our supper. Something in the far reaches of the cave rustled. My senses sharpened. There were visitors, scores of them. They were so tiny and slept so soundly during the daylight hours that neither of us had sensed them. A vast black cloud of them rushed out of the mouth of the cave, rising into the dusk on flittering wings. Bats! I leaped to my feet, laughing with unexpected delight. The clouds split and streamed around me. Nearly inaudible cries filled the night. I spun around amidst the rising swirl. Can we keep them?
Are you mad, child? My mother asked, but she was smiling.
No, there's the source of the stench right enough. We'll let them feed and drive them out in the morning.
All right. I gazed wistfully after the swarm. My mother's smile deepened.
Never doubt you're a true child of the Maghuin Dhonn, Moirin mine. From what little I've seen of Donjalines, none of them would dance amidst a bat swarm.
I dropped back to the hearth and sat cross-legged in my travel-worn blankets, cupping my chin in both hands. What was he like?
Your father? She poked at the fire, stirring the embers.
A flurry of sparks arose, chasing the feeding bats.
Passing fair to look at. They're a lovely folk, you know.
I felt insulted. And we're not?
Her brow furrowed.
"'Tis different.
There's a keenness to it, a symmetry, like a well-tempered blade."
She smiled wryly.
"They certainly think well enough of themselves for it."
"Did my father?"
"No," she said slowly. "He was different. Lovely, aye, but he didn't strike me as one to use it as a weapon." She gave me a quick glance, and for the first time I saw shyness in her. "Offer it as a gift, more like. Beauty and desire."
"Milky white skin and green, green eyes," I said.
"Aye."
"What else?" I asked when she said nothing further. My mother sighed.
"What would you have me say, lass?" We barely spoke. On the surface he was calm, but desire moved in him like a current, deep and strong. When I looked into his eyes, I felt it.
She touched one hand to her chest.
And inside me, the voice of the Dia Arnhem said, "Yes."
"Do Dangelines have a Dia Arnhem?"
"No." She shook her head. "I know only a bit. They believe they are descended from their own gods. One was born of Earth. The others..." She stirred the fire again and watched the sparks rise. "The others came from beyond the stars. One of them called him to me."
"Is it true?"
She shrugged. "Mayhap."
I thought about the bright lady. My memory had faded, but I remembered beauty as keen and deadly as a blade. It drew me and frightened me to think on it now, knowing what I knew. But the man with the seedling had been gentler and different. "Mother, in the morning there's somewhat I wish to show you."
"All right, my heart."
In the morning we went to the meadow to gather pennyroyal. It had passed its prime, but it would suffice to dispel the lingering odour of bat droppings once we'd driven them out. My mother cast curious glances in my direction, but asked no questions. In the meadow I found a plant that would suit my purpose, a dandelion only just beginning to go to seed.
"This," I said. "Watch."
"'Tis an old plant. The greens will be bitter."
My mother's voice trailed off as I knelt and cupped my hands around it. I breathed in sunlight and warmth. Blew it out. It was hard, harder than before, and I understood without words that it had been easier before because I'd attempted it at midsummer, and it had been a smaller thing I'd attempted with the buttercup. The effort made me dizzy, but I held to the sense of rich, fertile brightness and kept blowing steadily until I saw black spots before my eyes. The dandelion blossomed into a sphere of gossamer seeds. "Stone and sea," my mother whispered. I took a few deep, gasping breaths. "Whose magic, ours or theirs?" "Yours," she said firmly.
"But why? What's it for?"
She crouched beside me and blew softly on the dandelion ball. An ordinary breath. The fairy seeds blew away, drifting into the warm air. She watched them go.
"Must it be for anything?"
"It seems it ought."
She shrugged. "Then no doubt it will be revealed in time."
My mother could be somewhat infuriating. "I saw a vision," I said, "in Clonderry, outside the fields. a man all ringed around in brightness, with a seed sprouting from the palm of his hand.
Oh?
Very infuriating. Mother!
Peace, Moirin.
She laid her hand atop my head.
Mayhap you glimpsed some fertility god worshipped by the Culloch Gorum. Mayhap it was ascending of one of the gods of Terre d'Ange whose blood runs in your veins. I do not know. It awakened you to certain gifts, which is to the good. But you recalled that the purpose of our journey was to be reminded that gifts must be used wisely.
I murmured. She rose and helped me to my feet. I stood swaying.
Was this a wise use of power? Exhausting yourself to accomplish what would have occurred naturally in 2 days' time.
I wanted to show you, I said stubbornly.
And so you have. She kissed my cheek. Come, we've unwanted visitors to dispel.
I sighed and went with her. 4 days later, I met Killian. I'd been ranging in the pine wood to the southeast of our home site to gather dry, fragrant pine needles to stuff new pallets for my mother and me. I left off with my basket half full when a light rain began to fall. I didn't mind the rain, but it wouldn't do to gather damp mast. I headed for home with the basket slung over one shoulder and my bow and quiver over the other. Silvery raindrops slid from the needles overhead. Birds twittered in the boughs, telling one another all was well with the world. If I'd been paying attention, I might have sensed him before I saw him, but I wasn't and didn't. It was plain luck that I came upon him from behind. Luck, and the fact that I moved quietly. He was crouching behind an outcropping of stone that overlooked our hearth, peering over the edge. The sight startled me enough that I let my basket fall to the ground with a soft thud.
"Who's there?"
He scrambled to his feet and whirled, but I had already summoned the twilight. A boy. I guessed he was a couple years older than me. I couldn't see his colouring properly in the dim twilight, but he was fair-skinned. He turned his head from side to side, one hand hovering over the hilt of a dagger.
"Who's there?"
he called again. I unslung my bow and knocked an arrow. "Who asks?" His eyes widened.
"Dagdamore!"
He glanced all around for the source of my voice, but there was nothing to see. He had heard me speak only because I willed it.
"Where are you? Will you not show yourself?"
When I didn't answer, he stooped carefully and picked up a bulging satchel.
"Come, I mean no harm. I'm Killian MacTiernan of Innisclan. I've brought an offering."
He untied the drawstring and opened the satchel.
"See, fresh peaches."
The peaches smelled ripe and heady and wonderful. I hesitated.
"You don't want them?"
Killian tugged the drawstring closed.
"All right then, I'll take them away."
"Just leave them and go."
"Ah, no."
He shook his head. Even through the gloaming, I could make out the glint of curiosity and bravado that lit his eyes.
"Don't the old ones love a bargain? Show me your true form. Just a glimpse. I'll take my leave and the peaches are yours."
I really wanted those peaches. I let the twilight fade, keeping the arrow trained on him.
"Dagdamore!"
He stared at me. In daylight, his hair was reddish brown. He had grey eyes and a smattering of freckles across the bridge of his nose.
"Are you flesh or spirit?"
"Flesh."
"And this is your true form?"
I gestured with the arrow. "You may put down the peaches and leave now." Killian continued to stare at me.
"You're just a little girl."
I was beginning to get annoyed.
Well, and so?
A wide grin crossed his face.
You don't imagine you could hurt me with that toy bow and bit of elf shot, do you?
I do. We regarded one another.
Why do you not vanish? He asked, curious. I've had my glimpse, have I not?
I can't, I said irritably. You're looking at me.
So?
It doesn't work that way. You can't hide from an eye that's already on you.
He chuckled. Then you must have a right great fondness for peaches.
I loosed my bowstring. The arrow thudded into the bulging canvas satchel. Peach nectar oozed around the shaft. I had another arrow knocked before he could react.
Are you mad?
He shouted, holding the satchel in front of him like a shield. I come bearing a gift. And spying.
Well, you didn't have to show yourself, did you?
Apparently I did, if I wanted the bedamned peaches, I shouted back at him.
You shot the bedamned peaches.
For the space of a few heartbeats we glared at one another. Then Killian sighed and lowered the satchel. He took a step backward, raising both hands.
Truce, eh? I spoke you fair. I mean no harm. I wanted only to see what was here.
I lowered my bow. Why?
I was curious.
His tone was frank.
All these years and no one's ever had so much as a glimpse. No one imagined there was a child.
My heart thudded. Do you mean to tell them?
Tell them what?
Killian smiled ruefully.
That I well-nigh got shot by a wood sprite with a child's bow.
He looked at my expression and sobered.
Nay, I'll not speak of it if you wish. I'll make you a bargain. Give me your name, and I'll give you my silence.
I paused. Moirin.
Moirin, he nodded. My word on it.
I made another gesture with the tip of my arrow. You should go now.
All right.
He turned, then turned back. I had already breathed a cloak of twilight around me. Killian blinked.
Moirin?
I didn't bother to make myself visible. I?
May I come again?
Why?
He shrugged. I like tales of magic. This is the nearest I've come to living in one. I'll bring more peaches, he added, when I didn't answer.
I plucked out the arrow that had pierced the satchel and licked the gleaming nectar that coated it. It was thick and sweet, tasting of long hours ripening on the branch and sunshine's promise fulfilled. These are the last harvest.
They are?
Killian sounded startled.
Apples, then. Whatever you like.
Apples, I agreed. And honey cakes.
He grinned. Apples and honey cakes it is.
Chapter 4 Killian Mac Tiernan, my mother mused.
I nodded. Are you angry?
At who? She bit into a peach. Him for spying, or you for showing yourself?
Either.
Neither. She shook her head. He's a lad. They're full of curiosity and daring at that age. And mayhap I've protected you overmuch. You're old enough to begin making your own choices. I've no fear that Lord Tiernan will meddle in our affairs, even if the lad talks. The Dalriada know to leave well enough alone.
She took another bite, chewed thoughtfully and swallowed.
It would have been a shame to waste such good peaches.
I was relieved. You're not angry?
I am not.
Good, I said. Because I told him he could come again.
For the first time I found myself keeping track of the days. 10 passed before Killian returned. I dare say I would have sensed him this time. I'd not let my awareness lapse as I had before,
But there was no need. As though to apologize for his former stealth, he made a racket this time, clattering through the underbrush. Before he was even in sight, he called. Moirin? My mother and I were mending clothes on the hearth. I glanced at her. She raised one eyebrow in reply. My choice. I called. Down here. Killian's head appeared over the ridge, then the rest of him. He froze for a moment on seeing both of us, then scrambled down. I was pleased to see he was carrying a satchel even larger than the first one. He reached the hearth and looked uncertainly from one of us to the other and back.
Lady Funcher? He inquired, a little breathless. And who else would it be?
My mother sounded amused. He coloured and offered a courteous bow.
Forgive me. Well met, my lady. I am Killian MacTiernan.
Well met, Killian MacTiernan, she said. You've a look of your father. Is he well?
He is.
He proffered the satchel.
Apples and honey cakes, and I thought a wheel of cheese wouldn't go amiss.
She smiled. You're a thoughtful lad. I'd store these in the back and do you the courtesy of returning your satchel. Killian watched her walk into the cave.
Is that her true form?
I said. Why wouldn't it be?
You...
He paused, flushing again. I don't look like her, I said softly, understanding. Is that it?
No. Yes and no.
He blew out his breath.
You do and you don't. No mind.
He glanced around.
This is the whole of it. Your home.
You should know, I said. You spied on it long enough the other day. His flush deepened.
Dagda Mor, are you always so rude?
I blinked. Am I?
Aye.
I suppose so, then. I thought about how I might best make amends. Would you like me to show you how to catch a trout with your bare hands? Killian shrugged.
Why not?
I showed him first, working in ordinary daylight, reckoning it was only fair. It worked that way, too, only it took a lot longer, and you had to be almighty patient.
"'Tis no match for a hook and line,
he observed when I finally caught one.
Have you not got one? I'll bring one next time.
I shook my head. No need.
Don't be daft.
Watch. I deposited my fish in the creel and summoned the twilight, conscious of his gaze on me. He made a soft sound. Lying beneath the willow tree, I eased my arm back into the clear water. In the twilight, the swimming trout had a silvery gleam. Almost as soon as the slight ripples I'd created faded, I caught one.
Magic, Killian murmured. Did you make yourself unseen?
Aye.
Yet I could see you. It was only that the air seemed to dazzle about you.
He frowned.
Because I was already looking at you, is it?
Aye. I wondered if he were a bit slow. Did I not say so the other day?
He laughed. Peace, lass. 'Tis not every day one meets a witchling child. What other magics have you?
I tied the lid of the creel shut. I didn't wish to speak to him of the man with the seedling. None?
No, he teased. Can you not summon the wind and catch it in a bag? Can you not charm the birds from the sky?
It would be an abuse of the Maghuin Dhonn's gifts to charm a bird for sport, I said with dignity, and no one can summon the wind.
They say the master of the streets could summon the wind.
Killian leaned back against the willow's trunk and stretched out his legs.
He could cause the seas to rise at his command and call lightning from the sky.
But he gave away his book of magic, and it's hidden away forever. He gave me a curious glance.
I've heard you speak no spells.
Spells? I repeated.
Incantations, words of power, invocations to the gods.
No.
In the twilight, words might have a certain power, but I didn't think that was what he meant. It's just a gift. His grey eyes were bright. Could you teach it to me?
I could try, I said dubiously. But I don't know if it would be right. I'd have to ask my mother.
Will you?
Aye, all right. I trotted back to the hearth and put the question to my mother. Her eyes crinkled with amusement.
So that's what he's after, is it? Oh, aye, let him try till he's blue in the face. He'll take no harm from it.
She was right. I explained it and demonstrated over and over, but it made no difference. Killian couldn't get the knack of it because he hadn't the gift. He couldn't raise so much as a glimmer in the air around him. His figure remained stubbornly, solidly visible. After 2 hours, he stomped around in frustration, kicking at willow roots. I sensed a shiver of distress in my favourite fishing tree as his boots scraped away chunks of bark and laid bare the pale root flesh beneath. "Please don't," I murmured. "You're hurting it." He scowled and knocked on the trunk.
"Trees don't feel."
"They do."
He glanced at the sky. "I should be going anyway."
"All right, then." I went to fetch the empty satchel for him. If it was magic he sought to acquire, after today's failure, I didn't think he'd be coming back. The thought made me sad. "Thank you," I said. I tried to think of something else to say that wouldn't be rude. After all, he had brought honey cakes. "It was interesting to meet you." He slung the satchel over his shoulder.
"Is there aught you'd like me to bring next time?" he asked, casting a critical eye over the neatly folded pile of mending on the hearth. "Clothing that's not in rags and tatters."
I was surprised. "You're coming back?"
Killian looked hurt. "You'd rather I didn't?"
"No, no," I smiled. "It would be nice if you did. Thank you."
I thought about his offer. I'd no need of fine clothing, but there were other things I liked.
"Sausages, mayhap?"
He smiled back at me. "Sausages it is."
After that, Killian became a regular visitor. Sometimes 8 or 10 days would pass between his visits, sometimes only a few. I couldn't teach him magic, but I taught him many things about the woods. Although he hadn't the deeper senses I did, he was still able to pay attention and learn a great deal. And he, in turn, taught me. It began the first time I returned to our camp from foraging in the hickory copse to find him already awaiting me. He was sitting cross-legged on the hearth, gazing intently at an object he held in his lap, so intently he didn't hear me approach. I decided to play a trick on him and set down my basket softly, summoning the twilight. Unseen, I crept near and plucked the object from his hands. Killian gave a startled yelp. I giggled.
"Moirin," he grinned, "show yourself, wood sprite."
I did. "And what is this object that held you so fascinated?" I inquired, waving it in the air.
"'Tis a tale of the Master of the Streets."
He grabbed at it, but I danced out of reach.
"I thought you might enjoy it, O ungrateful one."
"A tale?" I examined the thing. "How is this a tale?"
"It's a book, Moirin."
Killian paused.
"Not a book of magic, just a tale. Do you, know how to read?"
"Read?" The thing was shaped like a leather-bound box, but it fanned open to reveal a myriad square leaves with markings on them.
You don't, do you?
I held the book to my ear and heard nothing. I smelled it, then touched the tip of my tongue to the finely grained leaves. I know the words book and read, but I do not know exactly what they mean, I admitted. How is this a tale?
He took it from me. I'll show you.
Holding it open, Killian gazed into it and recited the opening words of a tale. I sat to listen, but he stopped.
Here.
He pointed to the markings on the first leaf.
These are the words I spoke, written here. Each of these is a word.
No, I marveled.
Aye.
That's a fine magic.
It's not. He paused to consider. Mayhap it is at that. I never thought on it.
I scooted closer to him. How do you do it?
See these shapes? Killian pointed again. Each one contained unto itself. Those are letters. They represent sounds. You put them together to make words.
Show me. He did, drawing on the flat stone of our hearth with the tip of a fire-blackened twig.
I marvelled over the process, taking to it like a duckling to water. I was so absorbed I didn't sense my mother returning with her bow over her shoulder and a brace of pigeons dangling from one hand.
What are you playing at, Moirin mine? She asked.
Oh, I startled. Killian is teaching me to read.
There was a shadow behind her smile. Is he now?
Killian got to his feet and bowed.
Not against your wishes, Lady Fancha. Speak, and I will cease. You're enjoying yourself? She asked me.
I nodded vigorously. Oh, yes.
So be it.
My mother laid a hand on my head. You have my blessing, but do not trust this new knowledge overmuch. Great truths should be contained in the head and the heart, not consigned to the page.
There was a time not long ago when the olives railed against the practice. The world changes, Lady Fancha, Killian said diplomatically.
She settled her gaze on him.
So it does. 'Twas your own kinsman founded the academy at Innisclan, was it not?
Aye, Eamon MacGronya. Your kinsman too, I believe.
He hesitated.
Moirin will prove a swift learner if I'm any judge. She'd be welcome to study there one day.
My mother looked alarmed.
'Twould not be for many years, Killian added hastily. None younger than 14 are admitted.
14, she sighed. I'm not going anywhere, I assured her. I just want to learn to read, that's all, and Killian's a fine teacher.
He coloured with pleasure. Am I?
You are. My mother regarded me with an unreadable expression.
Go on with it, then. My blessing is already given.
I'd spoken true. Killian was a good teacher. By the time the woods were ablaze with autumn's bright foliage, I was able to read simple texts on my own, sounding out the words aloud. Once winter came, Killian wouldn't be able to visit as often, but he had promised to bring me several books on which I might practice, whiling away the long, cold months. I had promised, in turn, to read them to my mother, and I do not think even she was entirely displeased by the prospect. But when Killian came next, he came empty-handed and downcast. No books, I was disappointed. He took a seat at the hearth, looking at my mother out of the corner of his eye. She was sewing a pair of rabbit-skin leggings. Killian was wary of her, fearing she didn't altogether approve of his presence in our lives. Also, he was still more than half convinced that she could turn herself into a bear. To be fair, neither of us had disabused him of the notion.
There's trouble, she guessed.
He nodded reluctantly and flushed to the roots of his auburn hair.
My father fears you've ensorcelled me.
My mother burst out laughing. His flush turned an angry hue.
Is it so unthinkable? Bear witches have done such things before.
Not to 13-year-old boys, I commented. Further embarrassed, Killian looked daggers at me.
It's because I've kept your secret, you know.
Peace, my mother said soothingly. Lord Tiernan flatters me. So you've said naught to him of Moirin?
I gave my word, he said indignantly.
And kept it like a man. She gave a brisk nod. Has your father forbidden you to visit me further?
Killian muttered. I defied him today.
That sound didn't bode well. What if I released you from your promise? I asked Killian. Would your father allow you to keep visiting if he knew it was me you came to see? I turned to my mother. You said you'd no fear that Lord Tiernan would meddle in our affairs. She made a non-committal sound, but Killian brightened.
You'd do that? He asked.
May I? I asked my mother. I got the raised eyebrow in reply. Again, the choice was mine. I said firmly. I would. Killian leaped to his feet.
I'll tell him and see.
He paused, giving my mother another sidelong glance.
You, haven't, have you, ensorcelled me?
Now she looked amused.
No, not I.
Chapter 5. Killian returned with good news and bad.
'Twould make a difference to my father knowing I came to visit Moirin.
He handed me a slim leather-bound book.
He sends this as a symbol of his earnest pledge. 'Tis the tale of the trials of Eamon MacGronia's courtship of his scaldic bride, he added. Fine winter reading, but...
Lord Tiernan doubts, my mother said dryly.
Killian nodded.
Lady Fanshawe, you've not been seen for nigh unto 12 years, neither here nor at Innisclan, and no one has heard any word of a child until now.
By my choice.
Which he respects, but if he is to allow me to continue my visits, he wishes to see Moirin with his own eyes.
My mother was very still.
Where?
He would welcome you to Innisclan. He pointed at the book I held. After all, you are kin. Will you not come? You've done him the honour before.
She shivered a little.
Once, for a great occasion. But I do not relish being within stone walls.
We live in a cave, I commented.
Her eyes flashed. Walls carved by nature's hand are not the same as those built by men's hands. Are you so eager to learn the difference?
No, I murmured, subdued.
And yet I am not eager to have Tiernan's people come here, trampling around with their great-booted feet and disturbing the woods, she mused to herself.
Killian shuffled his feet self-consciously. For a boy of 13 they were rather large. She ignored him and studied me with discomforting intensity.
Does it mean so much to you, Moirin mine?
Although the weight of her gaze made me feel like shuffling myself, I pondered her question and answered with one of my own. You said we had naught to fear from the Dalriada. Do I shame you in some way that you do not wish Lord Tiernan to see me?
Stone and sea, no, of course not.
Then why do we not meet him halfway?
I was proud of my solution. She was too. She gave a reluctant nod. Well reasoned. Killian MacTiernan, tell your father that Moirin and I will meet him at a place of his choose, halfway between Innisclan and here.
Aye, my lady.
He was off like a hare. My mother sighed. That lad was doomed the minute he laid eyes on you. I wasn't sure if I was intrigued or offended. Why ever so?
She gave me a wry look. 'Tis the way of the world, and men and women in it. Aye, the lads and lasses too. Pray you've a good many years before you learn it.
Not yet, the bright lady whispered. Not for many years. The memory made me shudder. I shall, I promised. 3 days later, we rode out to meet the Lord of the Dalriada. I'd never ridden a horse before. 'Twas Killian who brought her, a dapple-grey mare, leading her behind his stalwart pony and tethering them both before entering the brambles along the verge of our woods. I'd seen horses, of course, on our journey to Clonderry, but never at close range. The mare was grazing when we emerged from the thicket. She raised her head and gazed at us with lustrous eyes, munching on grass.
"How lovely!" I cried.
Killian rummaged in his pockets.
"I brought you a bit of dried..."
I had slipped into the twilight without thinking. "Hello," I said softly. She bowed her head and let me cup her muzzle, giving a grunting whicker in reply. Her coat shimmered in my vision. I blew into her nostrils. "Hello?"
"Moirin?"
"Oh," I let slip the twilight. "I'm sorry." He handed me a wizened apple.
"I thought you might be frightened of her. Here, hold your palm open."
I fed her the apple. Her lips tickled. "Why would I be frightened?"
"It was a foolish notion," he admitted.
"Lady Fancher, do you know how to ride?"
My mother was stroking the mare's shoulder. The mare turned her head to lip my mother's hair.
"I expect I'll manage. Your Uncle Declan taught me long ago."
Killian stared.
"He did?"
A kindness shown to a distant cousin.
"You do know we all share a common ancestor in the great Lady Gronia of the Dalriada."
She mounted easily and settled her skirts around her.
"Over to yon boulder, my heart," she said to me, guiding the mare with her knees. "You can mount up behind me."
In the exhilaration of the ride, I nearly forgot the purpose of our journey. We veered west, then rode south along a high stony ridge overlooking the sea. I clung to my mother's waist to keep myself from sliding around on the mare's wide back, my skirts hiked up to my knees, bare legs dangling. The wind was off the sea, cool and salt-smelling. At first we just walked, but once Killian saw that my mother could indeed ride and I didn't appear likely to fall off, he nudged his pony to a trot from time to time. My mother kept pace with him easily, though she let the knotted reins lie slack around the mare's neck.
"You've a knack for this," Killian said curiously to her. "Have you ever kept horses of your own?"
"No."
"Why not?"
"Whatever for?" she asked in turn. "What use is a horse in the woods?"
He shrugged. "You could go places."
"So I can on my own 2 feet without a great maw to feed."
My mother leaned over to pat the mare's shoulder.
"'Tis not our way to keep animals captive. I reckon they like it no more than I would."
Privately, I thought it would be quite wonderful to have a horse of my own, or mayhap a pony, since my legs were beginning to ache from straddling the mare's girth. And I wouldn't keep it captive either. It would live free in the meadows and come when I called it, obeying me out of love. We could roam the world and explore it together, free as birds. I'd never considered such a notion before. It was a new thought. It gave me a strange feeling, like the fluttering feeling, only higher. A feeling that made me happy and sad all at once. It made me uncomfortable.
I pushed the feeling and the thought away together. And then I saw them and forgot about it. There were 6 of them waiting for us on the cliffs above the sea, 3 men and 3 women, all astride fine horses. The man in front I took to be Lord Tiernan. From what I could see over my mother's shoulder, she was right. Killian had a look of him, although his father was older and bearded. Sunlight glinted on a gold torque around his neck. All of them wore fine, brightly coloured clothing. I glanced down at my shapeless, much-mended brown dress. It was very practical and faded to just the right hue for moving unseen in the woods. But for the first time, I wondered if I ought to have accepted Killian's offer of clothing and not asked for sausages instead. Although there had been very good sausages.
"Father," Killian said breathlessly, "I've brought them."
The man inclined his head.
"Fanshawe."
"My Lord Tiernan." My mother dismounted deftly, sliding one leg over the mare's neck. She helped me down. "This is Moirin, my daughter." I stood gazing up at them. They sat gazing down at me. Killian rattled off their names. Far below us, the grey sea crashed on rocks. At last, Lord Tiernan's gaze shifted to my mother.
"That child was never sired by one of Alban blood."
"Nor did I claim she was," my mother agreed.
"Who?"
She shrugged.
"Since when do the Dalriada concern themselves with the lineage of the Maghuin Dhonn?"
His mouth quirked.
"Others might. Or do the wild kin of Alice's line forget whose blood runs in their veins?"
"We do not." "Poor mite," one of the women whispered audibly, "living like a savage."
"What do you expect?" another murmured.
I glanced at my mother's face and saw her eyes take on an ominous glitter. I was angry on her behalf and gave the woman who'd spoken first a glare of my own. She flinched and made a warding gesture.
"Peace."
Lord Tiernan held up his hand, silencing them.
"Why not bring the child to be raised at Innisclan, Fanshawe?"
he asked in a reasonable tone.
"At least during the winter months. Surely it would be an easier living, and if she's an appetite for learning, it would be indulged."
She shook her head. "When Moirin is older, she may choose her own path. For now, she stays with me, and our place is in the wild." He sighed.
"Dag d'amor, you're a stubborn woman."
His gaze shifted back to me.
"What do you will, child?"
I curled my bare toes on the stony ridge. "For Killian to visit." Lord Tiernan's expression softened.
"So little? All right, then. If the lad wills it, I see no harm in it."
He hesitated.
"Fanshawe?"
My mother raised her brows coolly.
"Aye, my lord."
Whatever he was going to ask, it withered in the face of her implacable stance.
"Stubborn woman,"
Lord Tiernan repeated. His grey gaze lingered on me.
"I reckon the truth will out in time."
He gave his son a brisk nod.
"Killian, so be it. I'll expect you home by supper."
Killian grinned. "Aye, father." So it was decided. In the years that followed, Killian came without fail whenever he could. Not so often in the winter when the snow and cold made travel difficult, but he taught me enough before the first snowfall that I was able to read on my own, and as he had promised, he brought books borrowed from the Academy's considerable library. They were tales of Alban history, Alban heroes. During the long winter nights, I read them aloud to my mother by the light of the little fire that warmed our cave when we couldn't use the wind-scoured hearth, both of us huddled under furs and blankets. During the day, it was different. Cold as it was, I liked the woods in winter. It was quiet, so quiet. Almost all the world slept. There was only the murmur of pine trees, boughs pillowed white with snow, and the occasional bright crackle of holly. Animals were scarce. One could feel oneself alone in all the world beneath the vast sky, breathing plumes of frost into the bright air. No magic, only being. At such times, I could not imagine wanting aught else. But at night, there were tales, and I hungered for more. Spring came, and Killian came more often. He'd grown over the winter, turning lanky and raw-boned.
"Look at you," he teased me. "You're no bigger than a frog."
"I am," I said indignantly.
"Hardly."
My mother watched us indulgently. It wasn't until early summer of that year that Killian spoke of my parentage. Ever since our meeting with Lord Tiernan, I'd feared he'd broach the subject, but he'd waited, cunning as a hunter in his own way. We'd been roaming in the woods and were lying on our backs in the sunny meadow, head to head, in comfortable companionship.
"So,"
Killian flicked a spray of bluebells with one finger.
"Do you know who your father is?"
I sighed. He rolled onto his belly.
"Do you?"
I veiled my eyes with my lashes and squinted at the sun. "Not exactly."
"Moirin."
"What do they say?" I asked.
"Will you not look at me?"
Killian's voice was plaintive. I turned over and met his gaze, so close our noses nearly touched.
"Little frog."
He brushed a dusting of pollen from my hair.
"What are you frightened of?"
"I don't know," I said honestly.
"Dongeline."
His voice was steady.
"That's what they say, since you're asking after it."
"He was," I murmured.
"Who?"
I shook my head. "A priest, I don't know." Killian sat upright.
"Well then, there's a start. A priest, eh? A priest of what?"
In my mind, the bright lady smiled gently upon me, warming my heart and setting my stomach to fluttering. "I don't know."
"Do you want to know?"
I did and I didn't. "Mayhap."
"All right."
Killian eyed me speculatively. "There are texts in the library on the history and culture of Terre d'Ange, none, I fear, translated into Alban. But I've been studying Dongeline and Kerdiki in preparation for entering the academy. I could try to translate for you if you wished to learn more."
I was confused. "What do you mean?"
"They're not writ in your tongue, nor one you would recognize," he said patiently. "I could try to teach you as I learn it."
"Teach me?"
"To speak your father's tongue."
"How so?"
I was still baffled. "Are people not the same everywhere? Why should my father's tongue differ from my own?"
"It does," Killian assured me.
"Stone and sea!" I blew out my breath, exasperated by the very notion of it. "What a piece of confusion! Why would people do such a thing?"
He shrugged. "Would you learn?"
"Aye," I said slowly. "I would."
Chapter 6. "Naamah," I breathed.
"Naamah,"
Killian agreed, his finger hovering over the page. Our gazes met in triumph. It had taken a year for him to gain proficiency in the Dongeline tongue and teach it to me, a year to find the right text and for me to draw painstaking details from my recalcitrant mother. She glanced over our shoulders at the illustration of a priest in red robes, bestowing a careless remark on us.
"Oh, aye, that bears a likeness."
Killian rolled his eyes. I giggled. "Naamah,"
Desire. The bright lady had a name. I studied the page. I studied all the pages. I mouthed the Dongeline words to myself. Here was the tale my mother had sketched for me long ago, told in full. Eloa, blessed Eloa, first and foremost of their gods, all the rest had followed him. Fallen from heaven, fallen from the skies, they gave up their immortal heritage for him. Why? I traced his likeness. Born of the earth, nurtured there, conceived of the blood of a lone deity's mortal son and the tears of his mortal beloved, essences that mingled in the soil, claimed by neither earth nor sky, stone nor sea. He wandered. The others left heaven and followed him. I didn't understand it. I couldn't. It was too strange, too foreign. I couldn't grasp the tales. Were they gods or servants? Was Eloa their dia anam? My mother had said he wasn't, but if not, what was he? Why did they follow him? When he hungered, Naamah lay down with strangers to get coin that he might eat. And then they came to Terre d'Ange, where the people welcomed them with open arms. There they stayed and got many children, until the lonely god relented and invited Eloa and his companions back to heaven. But he refused, and went to a different place instead, and all his companions went with him. I looked at the illustrations again. One of them showed a priest in brown robes pouring out an offering of grain at the feet of a statue. The statue was of a man holding a seedling in the palm of his hand. Arnil, I said aloud.
Arnil, also called the Star of Love and the Good Steward, Killian read. He gave unto them many gifts of husbandry, and taught them to grow good things and care for the land. What's he to do with anything?
I don't know, I murmured.
I'd never told him about that small bit of magic I could do.
If my father was a priest of Naamah, do you reckon he's descended from her line?
Killian shrugged. Mayhap. After so many years, I imagine the lines are muddled. Why?
No reason. I closed the book. Well, now we know.
I could try to find out his name for you, he offered. I'm sure there's a register of important foreign guests who attended my father's coronation. Mayhap the priest's name is recorded in it.
I glanced at my mother's face. Her expression was unreadable. No, I said slowly, stroking the cover of the book. No, it's enough to know this much. Thank you, Killian.
He smiled. You're welcome, little frog.
And for a time it was enough. Knowledge, I decided, could be a fearsome thing. I knew who I was, Moirin, daughter of Fancha. I did not wish to become other. And so I locked the fame of the bright lady my father served away in my heart, along with the name of the man with the seedling, whom they called the Star of Love and Good Steward, and I prayed instead to the Maghuin Dhonn herself that I should be one of her children and no one else's. In the autumn, Killian began his formal studies at the academy, and I saw less of him. Still, he came when he could. By spring he'd grown another 3 inches, and his head was full of all manner of new tales and histories, as well as gossip about the young men and women studying with him.
"You must come when you're of age, Moirin," he wheedled. "It's only 2 years from now, is it not?"
"One," I said, offended.
"Oh, aye," he looked surprised. "That's right, I forgot. My sister looked older at 13."
It needled me that he should see me as such a child. I was old enough that I could survive in the woods alone. I could read as well as Killian, and I'd learnt Dongeline as fast as he could teach it to me.
but now he was reading works by Kedaki scholars and learning skills like astronomy and mathematics. Wherever he was going, I was being left behind. I said as much to my mother. She gave me her wry look.
Wait.
For what?
You'll see.
Angus came that summer. He'd come a few times since our pilgrimage to Clonderry. This time he eyed me critically.
She's not started her woman's courses?
He asked my mother. She shook her head. No, I'd have told you. I flushed. Whatever for? They exchanged a glance. It would mean you're eligible to be courted, my mother said.
Time enough and more for that,
she added in a firm tone, putting the subject behind us. That night she went with Angus. I lay awake in my nest of blankets, listening to the sounds of the night forest, trying not to think on what they did out there. When I closed my eyes, I saw the bright lady, Naamah, whose gift was desire. She held her hands cupped at her waist, then raised them and smiled at me. Soon, she said in a voice like honey, and opened her hands. A shimmering grey dove burst into the air, its fluttering wings echoing the fluttering deep in my belly. Soon. Soon came that autumn and winter. My woman's courses didn't start, but my body changed nonetheless. I grew tall, or at least taller than my mother. At first I was reed thin with it, but then that changed too. My breasts and hips swelled. Where once my body had been quick and nimble, it now acquired a lithe, nubile grace. I felt strange in my skin. Good, but strange. A world of sensation abounded. I craved it. I could become absorbed for hours in the softness of a piece of rabbit hide, running the down soft fur over my cheek, drawing a comb through my hair, the way my clothing rustled against my skin, the sensual warmth of thawing my hands over the fire after a day afield could make me shiver with pleasure. Ah, Moirin mine, my mother murmured, watching me, you're a beautiful girl. Am I? I asked, startled out of a reverie. She kissed my brow. You are. When Killian came that spring, for the first time in long months, I saw it reflected in another's eyes. I was boiling tender lily buds over the hearth fire and sensed him coming long before he arrived, a trail of disruption in his wake. He bounded into our campsite on long legs, his voice turned deep and booming.
Moirin! He shouted. Moirin! I'm sorry I've been away so long, but there's the most amazing news.
I stood. Oh, I? He blinked.
Moirin?
At that moment the balance of power shifted between us forever. I crossed my arms, folding them under my young breasts, and saw his gaze flicker over my body. And who else might I be?
Ah, Killian flushed. You've grown, that's all.
So I have, I agreed.
Aye.
He stood stupidly, staring. What news? I prompted him.
Oh, he started. Oh, aye.
He made a sweeping gesture toward the west.
There's a whole new land that's been discovered across the sea. An Aragonian explorer found it. It's all the talk of the academy.
Is it now?
It is.
Killian came toward me, dropping the satchel he carried. His hand rose as though of its own accord to touch my face.
Dag de Mor, he breathed. Have I been gone so long?
I leaned away from him. You have.
Forgive me, he begged.
I might. I ducked and picked up the satchel. What have you brought me?
It wasn't much. Stale oat cakes,
the dregs of last season's honey crystallized in the comb, a smoked ham that was nearly rancid, an illustrated history of the Master of the Straits. Killian flushed again.
I'll bring whatever you like next time.
I stepped close to him until we were nearly nose to nose. What I want is my friend back.
Moirin.
His voice was husky. He clasped my upper arms, his hands strong. It felt good. His dark grey eyes were intent on mine. I'd never noticed how handsome he was.
Have I not always been your friend?
I shrugged. When it suited.
It suits.
He kissed me. His lips were firm, but softer than I expected. Over and over Killian kissed my mouth. And then there was his tongue, probing tentatively. At first the invasion startled me, and then I welcomed it. I teased it with my own, teased and retreated, forcing him to delve deeper into my mouth. Yes, I thought, this. The bright lady agreed, amused. There was a sound of my mother clearing her throat. She was standing near the hearth, a brace of grouse dangling from one hand. Killian sprang backward. I eyed her.
So, she said wryly, already?
We were just... Killian began.
I can see well enough what you were about, my mother said.
Moirin, she sighed, grown as you may have done, you're a child in a woman's body yet. Have a care with it, will you not?
I didn't want to have a care with it, and I didn't want to be told I was a child. What I wanted was for Killian to kiss me again and find out what happened next. But there was a shadow of worry behind my mother's eyes that made me nod reluctantly and keep my peace. And so I sat plucking grouse while Killian spoke of the rumours surrounding the new land that had been discovered across the sea, of fabulous cities rising up from lush jungles, folk who dressed themselves all in jade and feathers, and gold beyond telling. It was all very interesting, but I'd rather have been kissing him. When it came time for him to leave, I walked with him to where his mount was tethered on the outskirts of the woods, feeling my mother's gaze boring into my back. Killian's stalwart pony had been replaced by a tall chestnut gelding, another sign that he was edging toward manhood.
He's a beauty.
I blew softly into the chestnut's nostrils. He wickered and lowered his head, but I might scratch his ears. Will you teach me to ride him?
Moirin.
Killian caught me around my waist. He turned me around and kissed me again.
I'll do what you wish, my witch girl, he whispered against my lips. Only tell me you're not Roth, and I'm welcome here.
Hmm. I pulled back in the circle of his arms. I am Roth, but only because I missed you.
I'll come again,
he promised, pulling me toward him and showering my face with kisses.
I promise.
Shall I make sure of it? I teased, tasting my newfound power.
How?
I slid my hands into his auburn hair and kissed him in reply, long and deep, pressing my body against his. Killian groaned into my open mouth. I broke off the kiss and slipped from his arms with a deft twist. The blood was beating hard in my veins, and I wanted more as surely as he did. But I knew just as surely that this was my gift, and I was in control of it. Will that do? I asked innocently.
Aye, he said in a daze. That will do it.
Chapter 7. My gift. Desire. It came to me as easily and naturally as breathing, and once woken, it refused to sleep.
I slid into a state of desire, as surely as a trout in the stream, only instead of being cool and swift and darting, it was warm and languorous. Killian came often that summer. Familiar as he was to me, I learnt him in a whole new way. I kissed the corners of his lips and the dimples that formed when they curled in a smile. I bit his earlobes and the sturdy, slender column of his neck until he groaned. I let him put his hands on me, revelling in the feel of them. Where once we had lain for hours in the meadow talking, now we lay and kissed for hours, until I felt my blood had turned to molten gold. Only the shadow of worry in my mother's eyes kept me in check.
Dog de Moor! Killian pushed himself away from me when I bade him stop.
He crouched for a moment, then rose and walked a few steps. I sat up and tugged the loose bodice of my dress back into place, watching him curiously. He glanced over his shoulder and winced at the sight of me.
"Do you know what you do to me?"
"Aye," I said softly. "You too." He spun, fists clenched.
"Why make us wait?"
"My mother."
"Oh, Manannan of the Deep, take your mother," Killian shouted.
I raised my eyebrows.
"I didn't mean it."
He flung himself on his knees before me like a penitent, shuddering.
"Ah, Moirin, forgive me."
I touched his cheek. "I do, of course I do." But I did wait. I spoke to my mother about it, asking her why it worried her so.
"You're young," she said shortly.
"How old were you?" I asked. She was stirring a pot of cattail roots and didn't answer for a long time. When she didn't answer the question I'd asked.
"Would you have the truth, my heart?"
I nodded, and her dark gaze met mine.
"It's a powerful calling. I fear losing you to it."
"Killian?"
My mother shook her head. "The bright lady's gift."
It was my turn to be silent.
"Did you imagine I didn't know?"
There was sorrow in her smile.
"I suppose you did. Children are slow to credit their elders. Yet how could I not, when I felt her presence there at your conception? How could I not, when it's hung like a bright shadow over you all your life?"
She laid a hand on her breast. "The dear Arnhem within me says that this is right, that this is as it should be.
For reasons I cannot know, the Maghuin Dhonn herself wills it. But I am a mortal woman, and I fear to lose my child, so I have sheltered you from it as best I could. And now that it has found you, I do but beg you to go slowly from me."
My heart ached. "Stone and sea, I'm not going anywhere."
"No."
"No," I laid my head in her lap. "No."
"Moirin mine,"
her fingers stroked my hair. "I pray it so.
Stay a child for a while."
"I will," I promised.
I did. It was hard, though, so hard. I wanted and wanted and wanted, and Killian's wanting added to mine, setting my blood to boiling. But I held off through summer and autumn, and then winter came again, necessitating distance between us and cooling our ardour. I took solace in the cold and the quiet. Then came spring. It was a time of greening and new growth, when the soil was damp and fertile. Every plant sent out new shoots, feverish with excitement. Every tree burst into leaf. All my nerves were on edge with it. When Killian came for the first time that spring, grey eyes hot with yearning and his shoulders grown broad and muscled, there was no question. I didn't even ask what he'd brought in his satchel. No more waiting.
Moirin.
His voice was hoarse.
Now.
Now, I agreed. In the meadow, he kissed me like he was starving, yanking at my gown with impatient hands. It should have been tender, but it wasn't. We'd waited too long for tender. I didn't care. The feeling of his calloused fingertips on my breasts drove me mad. Killian pushed my thighs apart, fumbling between us. I reached down and took his phallus in my hand. It pulsed against my palm, at once hard and soft to the touch. I fitted the head of it to my nether lips. His hips jerked forward and he groaned, filling me. Him inside of me, it was like nothing I'd ever felt. For a moment I almost panicked. His weight pinned me to the ground, pressed the air from my lungs. His chin ground against my neck. His hips moved convulsively. Over and over Killian drove into me, and the fullness was overwhelming. "Slower," I gasped. He shuddered and grated out a single word. "Can't." And then at the end, it changed. Just as his buttocks began to quiver and his back arched, discomfort gave way to pleasure. "Ah, no," I clutched his shoulder blades. "Not yet."
"Sorry,"
he spent himself helplessly in me. We lay quietly for a moment. Killian's breath was ragged in my ear. I waited until it slowed. "Can we try it again?"
"Aye."
He rolled off me and propped himself on one elbow.
"Forgive me, will you? That's a winter's worth of wanting you like I've never wanted anything else."
He traced a line between my breasts and down my belly.
"Gods," he whispered. "There's no one else like you, Moirin. No one in the world."
I smiled. "No." His fingers slid between my thighs.
"No."
He pulled his hand away. Milky seed glistened on his fingertips.
"No blood?"
Killian frowned.
"Was I not the first?"
"You were. Who else would it be?"
"Don't lie to me."
There was a note in his voice I'd never heard before. It made me angry. "Why would I?" I retorted. "I'm a free woman, Killian. If I choose to take another lover, I would, and it would be no concern of yours. But I'd not lie about it. There's no one else." Killian sighed.
"I'm sorry. It's only that the thought of anyone else having you puts a knot in my guts."
I thought, choosing my words with care. "You do not have me, Killian MacTiernan. No one has me. I am my own to give. Is that understood between us?"
After a moment, he nodded. "It is."
"Good." I reached for him. "Now let us try this again. Only this time, I want you to go more slowly and not spend so quickly. Is that understood?"
He grinned. "Aye, mistress."
The second time was better. I was slick inside with his seed, and there was no discomfort. Killian moved slowly inside me, propped on his arms, watching my face. I felt a quickening deep inside me and found my hips moving to match his rhythm without thinking. Killian thrust harder, and this time I wanted him to. Stone and sea! He was so big and so deep inside me. Faster, now, faster and faster. What my body wanted seemed just out of reach. And then it wasn't. Deep, deep ripples of pleasure burst inside me. I abandoned myself to it, grabbing his buttocks, moaning mindlessly. The bright lady opened her hands, and an entire flock of doves took flight.
"Oh, gods," Killian whispered reverently.
When it was over, I felt calm and happy. We lay drowsing in the meadow, limbs entwined. A curious dragonfly came to investigate, hovering above us on gossamer wings. I stretched out one languid arm. It lighted briefly on my forefinger, regarding us with eyes faceted like gems. Killian's breath stirred my hair.
Magic?
Only the ordinary, everyday kind. I watched it take wing.
Moirin?
I looked at him. Aye. His face was solemn.
Marry me.
I sat upright with a jolt. What?
I'm serious.
He leaned on his elbows.
I miss you when we're apart, and I dare say you miss me too. So why ever not?
I said the first thing that came into my head. I'm too young. Killian gave my naked self a pointed look.
Oh, aye.
It made me smile reluctantly. I'm not ready, Killian. I've not even begun to think about it.
Surely you don't plan to spend the rest of your days living like a wild thing,
he pressed me. Why ever not? He made an inarticulate sound.
Dr. Moore, girl, you look like something that just stepped out of a fairy tale, and you run around in a dress that might as well serve as a gunny sack, with twigs in your hair and no shoes on your feet.
I felt at my hair. So? Killian tried a different tack.
At least do me a kindness. Promise you'll come to visit Innisclan and meet my family this summer.
I met your family, I reminded him.
You stood atop a cliff for 5 minutes and exchanged a grand total of 4 words with my father,
he said in exasperation.
And it was years ago. Come now.
He waved one arm around at the woods.
You've shared every part of your life with me. Is it asking so much of you to let me share a little piece of mine?
No, I murmured.
So you'll come?
I sighed. I will.
Chapter 8. I expected my mother to speak against the visit to Innisclan, but she didn't.
You'll pass the night there, was all she asked.
I said. I promised Killian I'd stay for supper, and it will be too late to return afterward. I hesitated. I won't go if you'd rather I didn't.
No, no, she shook her head. Whatever life you choose for yourself, you need to choose out of knowledge, not ignorance. Go.
So I did. Killian wanted to dress me in borrowed finery, but I refused. Let them meet me as I am, I said to him. If they reckon I'm not good enough to sit at Lord Tiernan's table, no amount of lace and baubles will change their minds.
He blew out his breath. Gods, but you're as stubborn as your mother.
And rude too, I reminded him.
Aye, he grinned, but oh, so very, very sweet in other ways.
It was afternoon when we rode into Innisclan, me behind Killian on his long-legged gelding. It had been 5 years since the pilgrimage to Clonderry, and it felt strange to leave the untamed spaces to which I was accustomed. Cattle grazed in meadows marked by low stone fences. Here and there we saw people who called out greetings to Killian. When they saw me, they stared, curious. It made my skin prickle, and I fought the urge to summon the twilight and conceal myself from their prying gazes. At the top of a rise, we halted and regarded the green hollow below.
Innisclan,
Killian said in satisfaction. It was a vast stone hall surrounded by outlying buildings. Killian pointed out the mill and the smithy and the academy founded by Eamon Mac Gronje and his skaldic bride. In an adjacent field, a group of young men played a vigorous game involving sticks and a ball. When we drew near, they hailed him with shouts.
Killian, lad! Come, give us a hand!
and then they saw me and went quiet.
"That's the witch's daughter," someone murmured.
I'd fancy a piece of that," another voice declared boldly.
There was heat in their eyes. I could feel it on my skin, an itch of a different sort. It set the wings to fluttering in my belly in an unthinking response, but it made me nervous too. There was no care in their regard, only hunger. I was glad when Killian shook his head at them and kept riding. Desire, I thought, could be a dangerous gift. At the stable, Killian dismounted and helped me down. The freckled lad to whom he gave the chestnut's reins stared at me with frank awe.
"Witch girl," Killian kissed my lips. "Come, meet my family."
I went with him. The doors to the hall of Innes Clan were tall, wood bound with steel. One of Lord Tiernan's men inclined his head to Killian, doing his best not to stare at me. The tall doors swung open. Despite the brightness of the day, it was dark inside. I hesitated on the lintel, curling my toes on the cool stone. I'd never been inside a man-made dwelling.
"There's naught to harm you here, Moirin," Killian said softly. "I swear it."
"Moirin!" A young woman hurried toward us, her arms extended. She caught my hands in hers and squeezed them, her eyes bright. "You've come at last."
"This is Aisling," Killian said. "My sister, the heir."
She hadn't been at the meeting atop the cliff, but I would have known who she was without him telling me. They both had a look of their father.
"Well met."
Aisling kissed me on both cheeks. Still holding my hands in hers, she regarded me.
"Tagda Moor, Killian. She's a vision to be sure. But could you not at least have offered the lass the loan of a decent gown and a pair of shoes?"
He said. "No mind." Paying our words not the slightest heed, Aisling tugged me across the threshold. "Come with me. I've things you can borrow."
"I'm fine," I managed.
She gave me a hurt look. "Ah, now, would you begrudge me the pleasure?"
No.
"Right you are." Aisling gave another smart tug on my hands. "Come along then." I went with her, casting a helpless glance over my shoulder. Killian shrugged, equally helpless. To my eyes, Aisling's bedchamber was a small, cramped space. The moment she closed the door behind us, I felt stifled and confined. The room had one window, and I hovered close to it, breathing fresh air in anxious gulps, while she pulled gowns from a chest, holding them up and examining them. "This ought to suit," she said of a gown of fine-combed green wool. "It will set off your eyes." She glanced up at me. "Are you all right?"
I
said weakly. "'Tis my first time indoors." Her eyes widened.
"Ever?"
I eyed the closed door. Killian's sister was a quick study. She followed my gaze and hurried to open the door.
"Better?"
Something in my chest eased. "Thank you. Yes."
"Right then."
She stood in the doorway with her back to me. "I'll stand sentry duty, shall I? You try on that gown." The gown fit nicely, only a little loose. I smoothed it with both hands, feeling the fineness of the weave, and glanced down at myself to admire the way the fabric clung to my body. Aisling turned around to regard me with approval.
"Let's do something with your hair, shall we?"
Without waiting for my reply, she pointed at a chair.
"Sit."
I sat. When I was little, my mother would comb the tangles from my hair, but it was a painful process and we'd never had a brush. This felt good. I relaxed with pleasure,
as Aisling ran the brush through my hair. She laughed at my expression. I've a cat that gets that very look when she's being petted. I noticed that when she smiled, Aisling had the same dimples that her brother did. I wondered what it would be like to kiss her. Mayhap the thought showed in my face, because she cleared her throat and put down the brush with alacrity, moving behind me. I'll just put it in a simple braid. It didn't feel simple when it was done, braided and coiled and pinned into place. Aisling picked up a silvery object and handed it to me. See how you like it, she said. The object was a mirror.
I'd never seen a true reflection of my own face before. I studied it. With my hair coiled neatly, it was easy to see. There was the stamp of my mother's blood and the angle of my cheekbones, the shape of my chin. But it was all different, too, and I did have very green eyes.
Do you like it? Aisling asked. I touched my hair. Oh, yes, it's lovely. Good. She busied herself with finding a pair of velvet slippers that matched the gown. They were narrow and pinched my toes, but I suffered it, reluctant to deny Killian's sister the pleasure it gave her. Aisling clapped her hands together. Perfect. When we returned to the main hall, Killian gaped at me.
Moirin?
One and the same, I agreed. Unexpectedly, he offered me a courtly bow.
And the very picture of beauty thus adorned. Come, will you see the academy?
It was large enough to house over a dozen scholars. The students were just settling into an early supper in the dining hall, young men and a few women, sons and daughters of nearby estates. I recognized several of the young men from the game in the field. While their regard was still avid and curious, this time it was more circumspect. It occurred to me, trying not to hobble in my too tight slippers, that attire was another form of concealment. Killian showed me the library, the pride of the academy. Running my fingers over the spines of countless volumes, peering at the enticing scrolls in their cubbyholes, I could almost imagine myself studying here. Then he showed me the quarters where the women lodged. I shuddered. It was a long, windowless room with a row of narrow beds in it. Just looking at it made me feel trapped and frantic. Ah, no, I said feebly. I think not. Killian pulled me away.
You wouldn't have to stay here if we wed, he said in a cunning tone. We'd stay in the great hall, you and I.
Somehow, I doubted his chamber was any larger than his sister's. I'll think on it. And then we returned to the hall of Innis Clan for our own supper. Although it seemed very fine to me at the time, I know now that it was a modest affair, with only immediate family in attendance. None of the others I'd encountered atop the ridge long ago were present. Only Lord Tiernan and his wife Caitlin, Aisling, Killian. Me. When the first course of leek soup was served, I picked up my bowl without thinking and set my lips to the rim. They stared at me in horror. Lady Caitlin actually blanched. Like this, Aisling said gently, demonstrating with her spoon. Oh, I murmured, feeling foolish. I wasn't ignorant. I knew what a spoon was. I had a very nice one carved out of horn somewhere. It was just that we did without when it was easier, which was most of the time. After that, I watched and learned. To be truthful, there were some implements with which I was unfamiliar. This utensil went in that hand. One did not eat until all the table had been served, and Lord Tiernan ate the first bite and nodded, signifying all was well. In between bites, one patted one's lips with the crisp white cloth that had been provided. In between courses,
One dipped one's fingers in a bowl of warm water, then wiped them on the selfsame white cloth. The conversation was stilted and awkward. Killian was no help, turning sullen beneath the weight of his parents' apparent disapproval of me. Aisling did her best, asking me about my studies and which of the books I'd read was my favourite. At least the food was very, very good, especially the stuffed goose. At Lady Caitlin's behest, talk turned to matters of Innisclan, as she prompted Lord Tiernan to relate his efforts to cultivate a transplanted Dangeline grapevine that had been sent as a gift of the king. It seemed it was failing to thrive.
"Mayhap Moirin might have some insight," she suggested with polite malice. "Have you not been reading about Dangeline culture, my dear? I seem to recall Killian asking to borrow some volumes a while ago."
"I hardly think," Lord Tiernan began.
"Only a little," I interrupted him. "But if you'd like me to have a look at it, I may be able to tell you what's wrong."
My offer was met with a surprised silence.
"It's not to do with Dangeline culture. Moirin says plants speak to her," Killian informed them with a gleam in his eye, their discomfort restoring his spirits.
"Really?" Aisling looked interested. "What do they say?"
"Not much," I admitted. "It's not words, it's just impressions. You know the way it feels on a bright spring day, after a night's rain, when all the world is washed fresh and clean, and you can almost hear the trees stretching their branches and the leaves drinking in the sunlight?" Lady Caitlin looked dour, but the others nodded. "It's like that, only stronger."
"Fascinating," Lord Tiernan murmured.
And so nothing would do but that after supper, Lord Tiernan sent for the gardener who served as his would-be vintner, and we traipsed out into the field to examine the grapevine. In the warm light of the setting sun, the old stalk looked hardy enough, but the new growth was paltry, spindly, pallid tendrils barely clinging to the trellis. I stroked it with my fingertips, trying to hear without ears, while the aggrieved gardener demonstrated to Lord Tiernan, for what was clearly the 100th time, that the soil was rich and black and moist. "Too moist," the roots whimpered, longing for sandier soil. I wound a pale tendril around one finger, feeling the urge to coax it to grow. "The earth's too rich," I said instead. "This fellow here wants dirt that doesn't hold the moisture so well." I pointed up the ridge. "Do you plant him somewhere higher, where the water can drain? I reckon he'll thrive." The gardener looked indignant. I shrugged. It wasn't my fault if he didn't know his trade as well as he ought.
"Fascinating," Lord Tiernan repeated, stroking his beard. "I may just try it."
"You can't be serious," his wife said with asperity.
"Why not?"
For the first time he gave me a smile with a hint of warmth in it.
"After all, we've tried everything else, and it seems to me that when one is given advice by a beautiful young lady who talks to plants, one ought to heed it."
That didn't sit well with her. Fortunately, the sun was sinking beneath the horizon. When we returned to the hall, I professed myself exhausted and begged their leave to retire for the night. It was true, I was worn out from the unfamiliar strain of being around strangers. Aisling graciously showed me to a guest chamber even smaller than any I'd seen. I took off her borrowed dress and folded it carefully, uncoiled and unbraided my hair with an effort, then curled up in a proper bed with clean-smelling linens and tried to sleep. I couldn't, not for the life of me. I'd left my door ajar, and I could hear the unfamiliar sounds of human activity, boots scuffing, dishes clattering. I tried shutting the door, but then the trapped feeling closed in on me. After what was surely the better part of 2 hours, I gave up
and resolved to slip out unseen and pass the night outdoors. It was agonizingly difficult to summon the twilight, something that came as second nature to me at home. Somehow it was all different here in this hall built by men's hands, with history carved into every stone. Mine was a gift meant to be used by wild folk in wild places, and I'd suffered myself to be tamed today. Now that was a fearful thought. But I made myself be calm and remember, and at last it came. I stole out of the chamber with a profound sense of relief. The great hall wasn't empty. There was a sentry drowsing in a chair by the doors, and, of course, the doors were barred. I paused, realizing that I'd likely wake him if I left, and wondered if it was worthwhile. And then I realized that Lord Tiernan and Lady Caitlin were sitting in high-backed chairs before the hearth, speaking in low tones. About me. Don't care if it's rational or not, I don't like her, she was saying. There's something sly and uncanny about that girl. There was a quiet note of despair in her voice. Will you tell me you don't see it too? I hoped he would. Uncanny, I'd grant her, but sly seemed unfair, although, given the particular circumstances, I'd be hard put to argue it. No, Lord Tiernan said slowly. No, I do. I'll grant you she's not what I'd choose for a daughter-in-law. And yet Killian's utterly besotted. The note of despair gave way to hushed fury. Why ever didn't you put a stop to it? He sighed. I hoped the winter would cool his ardour. 2 years ago it seemed his fancy was passing. 2 years ago she was still a stripling child, she said darkly. Now, oh gods, what does she want with him? I don't know, Lord Tiernan murmured. I curled my toes in an agony of indecision. Part of me yearned to flee, part to retreat, and a third considerable part longed to reveal myself and shout at them that I'd never wanted aught of Killian but for him to be my friend, and later, lover. It was hardly my fault he was muddling everything up with this talk of marriage. Mayhap we could bargain with her, Lady Caitlin mused. They say the old ones like to make bargains, and I suppose she's one of them, whatever else she might be. Do you suppose we might bribe her to leave him alone?
With what?
He sounded weary.
They may choose to live like savages, but they're blood royal nonetheless. It's not as though I haven't offered our hospitality over the years. Money? He shook his head. They don't lack for it. There's a trust held in keeping for all of the descendants of Alice's line in Bryn Garadam, which Fancha knows perfectly well.
I blinked. She did.
It's Fancha that disappoints me.
Now Lord Tiernan sounded bewildered and angry.
Have I not always honoured her choices? Why does she send her daughter to bewitch my only son?
I'd heard enough. I swept past the drowsing guard and unbarred the great doors, flinging them open, then fled into the warm night. Behind me, there were cries of alarm. I ignored them. In the twilight through which I moved, the landscape of Innisclan looked silver-grey and serene. I made my way to the poor struggling grapevine we'd visited earlier. Now, while there was no one to see, I cupped its tendrils in my hands. Holding an image of dry, arid soil and bright, beating sunlight in my mind, I blew softly on it. The tendrils stretched gratefully, reaching for a more secure grip on the trellis.
Moirin!
Killian was blundering around the fields, a lantern in one hand. With his other hand, he held up his unbelted breeches.
Moirin! God's be damned, girl! You sodding little wood sprite! Will you not show yourself?
When he was almost on me, I did.
Oh,
He peered at me, then turned and waved the lantern in the direction of unseen pursuers.
"It's all right. Go back. I found her."
I folded my arms.
"Sodding little wood sprite."
"Hush."
Killian set down the lantern and embraced me. Despite everything, it felt good. I couldn't resist running my fingers into his crisp, springing hair.
"Too much, was it?"
"Your mother detests me," I informed him. "And your father agrees that I'm sly and uncanny, and he considers my mother a disappointment. Oh, and apparently there are further truths she's not yet seen fit to divulge to me."
He ran his thumb over my lower lip. "Aisling liked you."
"Did she?"
"Aye." Killian smiled in the starlight. "She said you need to remember that if there's a spoon on the table, it's meant to be used, and that it's not terribly appropriate to look at people's sisters as though you wonder if they might taste good, a sentiment with which I'm in particular agreement. But she liked you."
I felt somewhat mollified. "I liked her too."
He kissed me. "Give us a chance."
"I'll try." Chapter 9. I tried. For a year, I tried to think of myself as Killian's potential wife. The worst part of it was that I did love him. Being with Killian was the simplest thing on earth, familiar and uncomplicated. I loved the way our bodies came together. I loved to look at him in the aftermath of love. His dishevelled auburn hair, his limbs and torso, pale and sinewy and freckled, mine, golden and supple. We could talk for hours entwined that way. But I didn't want to marry him.
"Why?" my mother asked in her direct way. I shrugged.
"Why did you never wed Angus?"
She shrugged.
"My father," I guessed.
"No."
She drew the word out.
"That was," she sketched a vague gesture, "a gift."
"So?" I pressed.
"It wasn't the right time," she said firmly. "Angus, I mean."
"Nor is this," I said. "And his father. I think Lord Tiernan might come around in time, but Lady Caitlin despises me, and I simply don't think I'm ready to be any man's wife."
"That's fair."
"Killian doesn't think so."
"Moirin, my heart," my mother sighed. "I told you long ago, that lad was doomed from the minute he laid eyes on you. He wants you, all of you, all to himself. If you're not willing to give it and accept the same from him, you'd do him a kindness to cut him loose, for he'll never be happy with less."
The thought alarmed me. "And lose him altogether?"
"Likely."
"No," I shook my head. "No, I don't want that."
I tried a different approach with Killian. I was nearing 16, and my woman's courses had yet to begin. I knew it troubled my mother, for I was a woman grown in all other ways, and it had begun to worry me too. When I told Killian I feared I might be barren, it had the dubious advantage of being true. He was quiet for a long time.
"I should have noticed, but women seldom speak of these things with menfolk."
"They do among the Maghuin Dhonn," I said, remembering Angus and my mother discussing it.
"Still," Killian gathered himself with an effort. "It doesn't matter," he said, sounding as though he were trying to convince himself. "I'm not my father's heir. It doesn't."
"It does," I murmured. "You should wed someone who'll be a proper wife to you and a mother to your children. Nothing would have to change between us."
"I don't want a proper wife," he shouted at me. "I want you."
I thought that might have changed matters between us, but the next time Killian returned, he was all smiles.
"You're not barren," he informed me. Oh? I raised my brows at him. Are you a midwife now?
No.
He settled himself comfortably on the hearth. But I spoke to a woman who is. And she spoke to another, who spoke to another, who recalled old tales her granddam told her, from when the old master of the Straits was overthrown and Dangeline's first came to Alba.
He pulled me onto his lap.
We live in a remote corner of the world. Seems it's common knowledge in Bryn Garadam. Like it or not, you're half Dangeline, Moirin, and you take after your father's kind. It's different for you. You'll not be fertile until you besiege their goddess Aishith to unseal the gates of your womb.
Truly?
Truly. Killian nuzzled my hair. Elsewise I'd have gotten you with child 10 times over, wouldn't I? And then you'd have to wed me. I laughed.
Oh, I, like my mother wed my father.
His face darkened.
Ah, now don't. I laid my hand across his lips. If it's true, it's wonderful news. Can you not just let me enjoy it?
He nodded reluctantly, and we spoke no more of it that day. That night, I told my mother. She gazed at me in shock, her lips parted. Is he certain? I thought she'd be happier about it.
Aye, I said, fairly so. He says it's common knowledge in Bryn Garadam. Killian wouldn't lie, I added, offended on his behalf, if that was what she suspected. Not about this.
No, she murmured. No, I suppose not.
Her dark gaze was fixed on the distance.
If it's true, it changes things.
A shiver ran the length of my spine. What things?
She didn't answer. A rare wave of anger swept over me.
Stone and sea, mother! Is there to be no end to the secrets you keep from me? My parentage, my namesake, the bright lady? What of the funds held in trust for Alice's line?
I'd been waiting for the right moment to ask her, but now it just came out along with everything else.
Were you ever going to tell me about that?
She looked startled.
What? A trust in Bryn Garadam.
I shook my head impatiently.
No mind. What were you going on about now?
I forgot about the trust. Her voice was soft. Forgive me. It's yours to draw on if you wish. I've a signet ring my own mother gave me hidden away somewhere. That's the token. I'll find it if you like.
Mother.
She stirred the embers of our hearth fire with a long stick. Among our people, a year after you enter womanhood, you're to be presented to the Maghuin Dhonn herself to be accepted as one of her children.
Or not? I asked, chilled.
Or not, she nodded. She does not always show herself.
I was silent for a while. What happens if she doesn't?
Oh, my mother poked at the fire, her head averted. If she did not, it would be because your heart had changed when you crossed the threshold from child to adult. It happens sometimes. Your gifts would fade. You would no longer feel welcome among us and would wish to leave. She lifted her head and her eyes were bright with tears.
I swear to you, I've no idea what will happen when you pass through the stone door. I only know I fear it.
Why? I whispered. Do you think she will not have me? She was honest.
I don't know.
Because of the bright lady, Naamah? I found myself on my feet and pacing. Or the other one, the good steward Arneel? Or is it because of Killian?
Mayhap all. Her voice was steady. Mayhap none.
I was trembling. I am your daughter. I am one of her children. I asked to be nothing more. If I am not, who am I?
Yourself.
One word, steady and sure. It drained away my anger. I sank down on the hearth and put my head in my hands. Forgive me. My mother's voice floated above me. Angus and I. When your courses didn't come, we thought it best to wait. And I didn't wish to worry you without cause. I should have told you. Yes, I raised my head with an effort. What happens now? The rite will be arranged. She hesitated. Unless you've changed your mind and wish to wed the lad. Killian. She gave me a ghost of her wry smile. Is there another? You know there isn't. I ran my hands over my face, remembering how hard it had been to summon the twilight at Innisclan. No, I do not. That was the cost of it all along, was it not? If I were to wed him and become the proper wife, his world would make me no matter what he claims. I would suffer myself to be tamed, and I would no longer be a child of the Maghuin Dhonn. Aye, my mother murmured, but as the wife of the only son of the Lord of the Dalriada, you would not be very far lost to me, so I do not speak against it. Do you speak for it? I asked. She summoned another smile, this one rueful. No. I would have you follow your heart, Moirin mine. Then I would seek the blessing of the Maghuin Dhonn, I said firmly. Whatever else I may be, whatever foreign gods seek to lay claim to me, I am her child and yours first and foremost. Whatever else may follow, all things proceed from that point. My mother kissed my brow. May it ever be so. Chapter 10. When Killian came next, he was in a rare state.
There's been a raid, he informed me, his mood somewhere between.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.